Kind. Well, good morning. Good morning. It is so good to be here in the Lord's house on the Lord's day with the Lord's people worshiping the Lord. Amen. There is nothing I'd rather be doing this morning than spending time worshiping God all together. It's so awesome. I love it. I love it. Well, we are continuing in our series, Satisfied, which is a study through the book of Colossians. And today we're going to be in Colossians 3, 18 through 4, verse 1. And while you're turning there, I want to tell you about my college years, my formative years as a college guy. And I got into rock climbing when I was in college. I know, I'm like an adrenaline guy. It wasn't quite like that. I just thought it was fun looking. And there was a climbing gym at my college. And I thought that was really cool. And I really wanted to do that. And so me and a couple of my friends, we all got together. And we decided that we were going to go on a climbing trip. Now, these, my friends, they had been climbing for a very long time. I had just started, so needless to say, I was terrible, and they were all really good, and they're like, let's go climb a cliff. And I'm like, okay, I'm in. So in climbing, there are different roles and responsibilities depending on what you're doing. So obviously you have the climber, who is the one who's doing the climbing, but then you also have someone called the belayer, who is holding the rope, making sure that the person who's climbing up that gigantic cliff doesn't fall, right? And they're held up by the rope that you're holding. Then there's also two other roles in climbing. One's called bouldering, which is you're not climbing as high, you're climbing without a rope, you're not climbing very high, so when you fall, you're not really gonna injure yourself too badly. And then the person who is spotting that person, so holding their hands out, making sure that that person doesn't land in a weird way and hurt themselves, they're spotting them. And so my role during this trip was I was the belayer. I was the guy holding the rope, okay? I wasn't good enough to be the guy climbing. I wasn't that good. I mean, I got to climb a little bit, but I was designated as rope-holding guy. I was belayer, and it seemed right, and I was happy to do it because my friends were all good, and I got to watch them, you know, do their thing. It was pretty awesome. So I'm on the rope. My friend starts to go up. It's getting higher and higher. It's like 75 feet in the air. And then my other two friends decide that they're going to start climbing too. And he's going to do some bouldering, so some lower level climbing without a rope. And the other guy's there and he's spotting him. And then my ADD kicks in, right? Because I'm kind of like a squirrel. Something's happening over here. I'm like, huh, huh, huh? And I'm losing focus. And truly, as a belayer, you have to be super focused on your climber, because if you're not and they fall, well, bad things can happen, right? And so now I'm not focused. Now I'm going in between these two climbers because I want to watch them because they're good. And I'm like, whoa, nice move, dude. I didn't really know what I was talking about at the time. Anyway, and then something happened. My bouldering friend fell. And I don't know if it was like this, I don't know, it was like a knee-jerk reaction where I thought that I had to be the one to catch him. I was like, I'll do it, even though I clearly had a responsibility and a role to do. I'm like, I'll catch him. And as soon as I go, he had a spotter, by the way, someone who was in that role ready to catch him, and I was like, ah, psh, I'll do it. And as soon as I let my hands off the rope, guess what happened? My climber fell. And so, just to let you know, I had the belay locked, okay? I'm not a crazy person, all right? It was locked, and so the rope was tight, and it wasn't moving. But something terrible happened to me. While I was arms outstretched trying to help my other friend, trying to step into another role, it literally took me off of my feet. If you've ever seen The Matrix, you know how they fly around? It was like that. And I was flying through the air with a lot of force, and I slammed right into the side of the cliff face. And I injured myself pretty badly. And I tried, like, needless to say, I was trying to operate outside of the role that was assigned to me, that was given to me. My role was to belay, to be focused on that. And I tried to step into another role, and it didn't work out great, left me injured. Luckily, when I hit the wall face, it also stopped my climber from falling. So praise the Lord for that. It really hurt me. But it was really good that it stopped him, and I felt pretty awful and embarrassed the entire time, and they still laugh at me today, which is great for me and my self-esteem. And I've never climbed since, so, you know, clearly that's not still sticking with me as a 30-year-old. It's fine. The truth is that God gives us roles, gives us roles as men and women and parents and children and leaders and workers. He wants us to operate in these roles because when we do, we're bringing God glory and we're bringing proper direction to our lives in the way that God intended. So the title of today's message is Embracing God-Given Roles. Like I said, we're in Colossians chapter 3, verse 18 through 4:1. Let's read that right now, starting in verse 18. It says this, "Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. Bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ. For the wrongdoer will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality. Masters, treat your bondservants justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven." That is our scripture for today. And so if you remember last week in Colossians 3, it has a parallel verse in Ephesians 5. Do you remember that? We talked about it a little bit. In Colossians, it's the word of Christ dwelling richly in us that produces teaching and admonishing and singing. And in Ephesians, it's the filling of the Holy Spirit that produces those same things. But you see, the list doesn't stop. It doesn't stop at those three things, teaching, admonishing, and singing. It goes on to list the same exact things that we're going to go through today in Colossians as well. And so before, in Colossians, before it was teaching these specific characteristics of the Christian believer individually. But then it also starts listing characteristics found in each person's role in the Christian family and life. So Paul has given the characteristics that the Christian should have individually, and now he's giving the characteristics that we should have in relationship at home and with others. And there's a reason that Paul starts in the home. There's a reason. He starts there and not like the entire world. He starts in the home because at home are the most significant relationships in our lives. At home is the most significant relationships. Husband, wife, father, parent, brother, sister. These are the most important roles and relationships in our life. And so when we get on God's plan in the home with these relationships, it's going to better equip us to take this into the world where we are called to be salt and light. So let's jump into the passage, shall we? Starting in verse 18. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Here's the first thing. Wives, submit to your husbands. Well, it seems like we're starting with a pretty light, non-controversial statement, right? Now, I will say this. This shouldn't be a controversial statement. In the proper context, this is a beautiful statement. Now, I know what you're thinking. Pastor Tommy, that seems like a little bit of a stretch. Like, submitting to my husband, that's a beautiful statement? It is. It's a very beautiful statement. And so let me explain. Let's start with the hot button word, submit, right? That's the hot button word. And I'm gonna show you why it's not controversial. I'm gonna show you why it's beautiful. And if you've never heard this before, I'm sure most of you have. If you've never heard this before, though, this is kind of going to blow your mind. The idea of submission, the idea of submitting, is not only found in the human interactions that we have. The idea of submission is actually found in the Trinity. The idea of submission is found in the Godhead. Jesus the Son, God the Father, God the Holy Spirit. Submission is in that, right? Jesus Christ submitted to God the Father. The Holy Spirit submits to both Jesus Christ and God the Father. And the beautiful thing about that is that this submission does not imply inferiority. Not at all, not whatsoever. All three persons of the Trinity are equally God. They are equally valued, but they differ in function and in role. And so men and women are equally human beings and equally share the image of God, but they have God-given roles and functions that mirror that hierarchy that we see in the Trinity, because that's how God designed us to function. So what does submit mean? Well, let me first explain what it doesn't exactly mean. Let me tell you what it doesn't exactly mean. It doesn't exactly mean respect. Doesn't exactly mean respect. Now, respect, of course, is a part of and a relation to submission, but it is not exactly meaning, word for word, respect. This is a word that is used by many people who are trying to soften the strong concept of what the word submit means. And can I just tell you, I don't want to soften anything this morning. I want to teach you the truth of God's word in its fullness. And so it does not mean exactly respect. On the other side is the word obey. The word obey is actually used in this passage twice, but not in the husband-wife relationship. It's used in the child-parent relationship and the leader-worker relationship. The choice of the word submit here is very intentional. It doesn't mean exactly obey. It doesn't mean that. And when we start to think that it does, that's where these attitudes of you have to listen to me, You have to obey me. You have to do what I say when I say it, right? This is used by, often, by domineering, authoritative, overbearing, browbeating, power-tripping men who use the word of God wrongly and use it to claim ultimate authority and dominance in their house. This is wrong. It's wrong. And if what I just described describes how you operate with your wife, one, it's time to stop that. Guys, look up here, okay? If that's you, stop it. Sorry, I had to use my dad voice, but this is serious, right? This is serious. It is, it really is. And two, I want you to pay very close attention to the upcoming point that's coming on a little bit later. And so if those aren't the words that exactly means submit, what does submit look like? What is the definition of that? Well, it is this. To submit is a voluntary willingness to recognize and put oneself under the leadership of another. It's one equal person's voluntary acceptance of the authority of another equal person. It is to recognize a relationship of order established by God. Now, this verse, wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord, is heavily influenced by the next verse, which is husbands, love your wives. Husbands, love your wives. It's heavily influenced by that. For by loving your wife, you often submit yourself to meeting the needs of your wife. It's heavily influenced by that. And I want you to note this in the text. It says, wives, submit to your husbands. Some of your translations might say, wives, submit to your own husbands, which I find really funny because it sounds as if Paul is trying to correct this behavior that's happening in the Colossian church of wives running around submitting to other people's husbands, right? Doesn't it sound like that's what he's trying to correct? That isn't it, okay? He's not correcting that. What he's doing here is he's emphasizing that this is an intimate, personal, vital relationship. Submit to your husband. This is yours. He is yours, and you are his. Submit to your husband. It's not some far-off, distant authority. This is your husband. It's very intimate and personal. The verse goes on to say, as is fitting in the Lord. This is saying why it's necessary. It's fitting in the Lord that you do this. If we are Christians and the Lord is supreme over all and has established the household and the family order, then this is right for the wife to submit. This is the way that God designed it. This is the way that the Lord created the family order. Now, I'll be the first to admit that the word submission is kind of tainted in our culture. Do you feel that way too? Sometimes a little bit. It's a little tainted. And I'll be honest with you, when I think and hear the word submission, my mind usually doesn't go immediately to the biblical definition of submission. It goes to kind of the secular definition of submission or the things that we see in our life. And it reminds me of like MMA or like UFC, right? Like, it reminds me of that, right? Submission, right? And look, that doesn't look great. Look at his face. He's not having fun, He's not having a great time. I'm going to guess that that probably hurts. He's probably in some pain. He's probably about to tap out. He's probably not enjoying that. He probably hates that. And so what can happen is we start to smush these words together, right? So submission, that's submission. And when you start thinking like that, it creates a really gross view of the word submission. That's not what biblical submission is. That's not what the Bible is talking about. It's not a fight. It's not a battle. At least it shouldn't be. It's where a husband willingly lays down his life for his wife. Ephesians 5 says, for husbands to love your wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. It's willingly laying down your life for your wife, not a tyrant who forces her to submit. And it is a wife willingly surrendering to her husband as he surrenders his will to Christ. Submission based on love brings peace and harmony to the family and fosters a right relationship with God and your spouse. Submission based on love does that. So how is submission to be done then? How is submission done? Well, I wrote down three things. The first is you need to have a correct view. It needs to be correctly viewed. Submission needs to be correctly viewed. It is not as inferior. You are not inferior to your husband. Remember, Jesus wasn't inferior to God the Father, but he submitted anyway, didn't he? It is not inferior. You are valued equally, and this is the way that the Lord has established the family order. The next thing is that it's not absolute. It's not absolute submission. This submission, really, to any human is always superseded by the ultimate submission that every believer owes to God. So if you look at, like, as an org chart, God's at the top. God's at the very, very top. So that means that a wife may sometimes have to disobey her husband if her husband asks her to do something contrary to God's word and will. It is not absolute submission. The third thing should be done in love. It should be done in love. This is your husband whom you are intimately, personally, and fully in love with. When submission is done in love, seeing the man that you married as God's gift to you, non-sarcastically, as someone who fully is yours and you are fully his, when it's done like that, it will make the act of submission seem like harmony, because that's the way that God intended it. So wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Then it goes on, verse 19. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Here's the second thing. Husbands, love your wives. Husband, love your wife. A lot of guys just stop at verse 18, right? They're like, wives, submit to your husbands. They're like, okay, we're all done here. Close this bad boy up. We're good to go. That's all we need to read for today. That's our daily reading. And then they close the Bible and then they move on with their life, right? And I think the reason that guys, and sometimes we do that, is because the next verse is very convicting for us, isn't it? The very next verse is convicting to and for a husband. And there's really two commands that we see here in the passage of loving your wives. That's the first one. Love your wife. That's the command. Love your wife. Now, this is both the feeling and the activity of love, okay? It's both of those things, the feeling of love and the activity of love. You need to be loving your wife with feeling. The feeling of love is certainly there in the dating, right? The butterflies, woo. And the engagement, certainly there in the engagement, that nervousness that you feel, right? When I proposed to my wife, I was sweating. I was so nervous. It's like, is she gonna say no? She said yes, it was awesome. And then the feeling of love is still there and growing when you're first getting married. Do you remember the moment your bride walked down the aisle and you're like, tearing up, and you're like, don't cry, I'm a man. I can't, right? And the feeling of love is certainly there in the honeymoon period of your marriage, that deep connection that you're making with your wife as you're living together. The feeling of love is there. But then over time, all the feelings of love seem to drain away. Before, you were filled to the brim with love for your wife. And then something happened over time, and now it seems like a lost feeling. That love is a lost feeling. The text right here is actually urging us to continue loving our wives. The Greek, the emphasis of this verse is, husbands, keep on continually loving your wife. That's the emphasis in the Greek. Keep on continually loving your wife. Continue loving your wife like when you were dating and engaged and first married. Keep that feeling of love going. And that's where the love as an activity comes in. See, it's a feeling, but it's also an activity. The activity of love keeps the feeling of love present. The activity of love keeps the feeling of love present in the relationship. And that action, that activity, is self-sacrifice. It's self-sacrifice. It's exactly what Ephesians 5 says. How did Christ love the church? By giving himself up for her, his life. It's self-sacrifice. My desires, my wants, my needs, sacrificed for my beloved. Love requires activity. It requires work. The constant need to continually be working on my love for my wife. It's both a feeling and an activity. The second command that we as husbands get in this is to not be harsh with our wives. It says, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. When I'm not working on loving my wife, the feeling of love and that feeling of love is fading away. The thing that's left in the wake of that is bitterness. And bitterness can replace love quickly if you allow it. Then with that bitterness comes a harshness of temperament, resentment. We shouldn't be ruling our households in a harsh and domineering way, because that leads to a bitter ruler for your wife to have to endure. And can I just say, men, let it never be said of us husbands that our wives have to endure under our leadership. They should be thriving, not enduring under our leadership. And it's really sad to see this happen in a marriage. And there are a lot of times, well, there were times in my marriage where this was threatening. Bitterness led me to speak harshly to my wife. Bitterness led me to lose my temper, to act out in selfishness, to not giving my time, to isolating myself away, to not being thoughtful. And something that really helped me a lot in this was, of course, prayer. But also, I wrote this down in my journal when we were in year two of our marriage. I wrote this down because people say that the first year of marriage is the hardest. That was not our experience. It was the second year of marriage that was most difficult for me and my wife. And so in the second year of our marriage, I wrote this down. And I wrote this down in my journal, and it's how I need to view my wife. How I need to view my wife. I wrote just a couple of things down. I need to view my wife as a sister in Christ. I need to view my wife as my best friend. I need to view my wife as the most important human being in the world to me. I need to view my wife as my partner, not my servant. I need to view my wife as worthy of all my time and investment. I need to view my wife as beautiful always. I need to view my wife as a daughter of God. I need to view my wife as my prayer warrior, and I need to view my wife as my first ministry. You see, when I view my wife in these ways, when I have a correct view of her, these are all true of my wife. These are all true of your wife. This is all true of our wives. When we view them correctly and we view them in this way, it helps spur love on in our hearts. I love my wife. I have a correct view of my wife. But when I'm harsh with my wife, it not only affects me in the way that I act and sin against my wife, but it affects her as well. It doesn't just affect me. When I'm harsh with my wife, I'm bitter with my wife, I'm resentful with my wife, it affects her too. It affects her probably in a greater way. It starts to break and destroy her when I'm bitter and resentful and harsh with my wife. It's like this weight that we're putting over our wives when we're bitter and harsh. And everything that we say, the bitterness that we have, the bitterness in which we speak with, the out of control temper, all of that is like a weight that's just laying on the shoulders and hearts of our wives. And the more and more that we operate in this way, when we choose not to love our wives and we choose to be harsh with our wives, the pressure and the weight becomes heavier and heavier over time, finally until it's completely crushing and destroying. And there may be some wives in here right now who have been destroyed by their husbands, broken, bruised. But can I just share with you? There's hope. And that hope is found in the Lord Jesus Christ. He can heal all wounds. He can right any path. He can give strength to make the needed change. It is never too late to turn from your sin and embrace Christ for forgiveness. Never is it too late. Never. And so if you are a man, a husband who has been this way with your wife, not loving and being harsh with her, can I just tell you, you can change right now. And you can do it through the power of the Holy Spirit in Jesus Christ. You can do that right now. You don't have to continue living the way that you're living. There is forgiveness and there is empowerment to live in the way that God asks us and tells us and commands us to function as a family. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Do not be harsh with them. So how do you love your wife well? I certainly am not the corner of them. I don't have this all together. Trust me, as I'm preaching this to you, I'm preaching it to myself as well. But I just wrote down some things. How to love your wife well. The first is, of course, self-sacrifice. We talked about that. Ephesians 5 says, love your wife as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for him. We need to, for her. We need to sacrifice self. Her needs over mine. My wants, desires, sacrificed for my wife. Christ gave everything for the church, and we need to imitate Christ in this and give everything for our wives. Number two, lead spiritually. Lead spiritually. This is definitely something that I need to continue and work on, leading spiritually in my own house. Direct and lead her in God's word and in prayer. Lead spiritually. Men, be the spiritual leaders of your household. Lead her spiritually. Bring her to God's word. Number three, cherish her. Cherish her. Speak love to her. Speak love to your wife. Tell her how much you love her. Tell her how much you cherish her. Tell her how much she means to you. Tell her when you see her, maybe you're sitting right next to her right now. Here's an awesome opportunity. Say, you are God's gift to me. That's true. Tell her, cherish her, love her, write her a poem. I don't know, like, love her, speak love, write her a song. Let her know how much you cherish her and care for her. Number four, build her up. Build her up, words of encouragement. If you see that she's doing something great, make sure that she knows it from you. Encourage her. Sweetie, you're doing this really awesome. I saw this. I saw the way that you interacted with our children. I thought that was really beautiful and sweet. You did a great job. I just want to tell you that. Maybe something happens and she does something in the home. And you're like, wow, that looks really awesome. You did a great job with that project. I'm really proud of you, right? Building her up. Build your wife up. Do not tear her down. Build her up. And number five, and this one is honestly probably the hardest for me, is be intentional. Be intentional with your dates and your time together and maybe even your gifts towards your wife. This is hard for me because I'm very spontaneous, right? And so, you know, I'll come home and I'll be like, all right, babe, let's go. We're going on a date right now. Here we go. Get on your shoes. We're going to go eat some dinner and it's going to be wonderful. And then we're going to go see a movie. I got it all planned. I just planned it about 30 seconds ago and it's going to be great. Now, my wife is the exact opposite of that. She's a planner, right? She is the exact opposite of spontaneous. She needs to plan things. And she's like, listen, you need to tell me things at least 30 days in advance before we, right? She is type A and I am type B. And so it is not a loving thing when I come home and I'm like, woo, let's get a babysitter. Let's go. We're going to have a great night together. That's not loving my wife. I need to be intentional. I need to be intentional with choosing and planning and making time together. I'm growing in this. I'm certainly not perfect. I am growing in this. I would like to share a success that I've had this week. I have given my wife exactly 5 days notice for a date that we're going on tomorrow. So it's, you know, I'm getting there. I've got about 25 days left to go to really get to the place where she wants that. But be intentional with your wife. Be intentional with your time together. That's how you can love your wife well. So we've got wives, submit to your husbands. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Then every parent's favorite verse, verse 20, children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Amen. Come on, wow, wow. This one seems pretty simple, right? I bet some of you right now are like, wow, that's a great verse. I should tape that to my child's door today to make sure that they see that and know it. I do love how all-encompassing this verse is. Obey your parents. Well, in what? Everything. Well, why? Because it pleases the Lord. Awesome. So I think that we should probably define some things in this verse. Because as a youth pastor, I know a thing or two about how this conversation can sometimes go, right? When you're telling and showing them this verse. They're like, well, it says children. Okay, mom and dad? That says children. I am not a child anymore, okay? I'm 13. I'm a teenager, right? It doesn't say teenager obey your parents. It says children. I'm no longer a child. Well, what does obey really mean in this passage? You know, what does it really mean? Are you sure that you know what it means? Are you sure? You sure? Oh, and I'm supposed to obey in everything? Really? So if you tell me to jump off a bridge, I'm just supposed to do that? Right? Can you hear that conversation? Maybe I laid it on a little thick, and to that, students, I'm sorry. Love you guys. Okay, so let's just go through it. Let's just go through it. We'll start with the children piece. I'm not a child. Here's what the definition of children is in the Bible. Parents, you're going to love this. In Roman law, children were the property of their father, which means the father had ownership of their children until they left his house. So, my question to you, child, is are you living in your parents' house under their guidance and provision? Because biblically speaking, you stop becoming a child when you go out and establish your own independence in your own life. If you haven't done that, you're still a child. Your age, whether 1 or 26, means nothing biblically. It means nothing, according to the Bible. And so I was still a child at 22 years old. That's what children means. That's who it's talking to. It's very broad. The word obey, this is pretty simple. To follow instruction, right? I say it, you follow it. Simple. That's obedience. In everything. So this is where we're going to have a little trouble with this phrase. It's not in a bad way, but there's a little trouble with this phrase. In everything, this sets the standard and lays down the principle for children. But the Bible is always emphasizing obedience to God over obedience to man, always. And so there may be justifiable cases when a child would not obey their parents in everything if that command is not given according to God's will, God's word. And so this phrase is making the assumption in everything that the parents are acting as responsible, dealing wisely and kindly with their children. Now, I know what you're thinking, children who are here, students who are here. You don't understand, Pastor Tommy. Like, you don't get it. My parents don't let me do anything. They, like, just always want me to, like, obey and stuff. Am I overdoing it again? I'm sorry. I'm apologizing. My question to you is, have you ever stopped to wonder, why? Why? Why do my parents never let me do anything? Is it perhaps because you're not super great at this whole obedience thing, right? They let you do something and they're like, all right, hey, you could go and do this, be back at this time. And you're like, well, I could come back like an hour late. Like, what's the big deal, right? It's just an hour. I mean, there's 24 of them in the day. Why wouldn't I just, you know? Your parents give you an inch and you end up taking a mile. Let me help you with something. Obedience to your parents is the key. It's the key that unlocks your parents' trust. When I am obedient to my parents, the more I obey, the more they trust me. The more I am obedient and trustworthy, the more they, it makes sense, right? The more I'm obedient, the more I'm trusted by my parents. Now, here's the great thing, is the more I'm trusted by my parents, the more willing they are to give freedom. Parents, right? The more I trust, the more I can give some a little bit more freedom. And so if you're a child and you're shouting from the rooftops, I have no freedom. I am oppressed by my parents. Perhaps you need to learn first obedience so that you can build trust and you can unlock the freedom that you so desperately are desiring. So then comes the why, because it pleases the Lord. It pleases the Lord. This again is making reference to the Lord establishing the household roles and functions, and so it is right and God-honoring for children to obey their parents. So really quickly, I just jotted down for the students and children who are in here, how do I obey my parents? How should I obey my parents? I wrote down three things. Are you ready? With respect, with urgency, and with excellence. The first one, with respect. I'm not groaning when my parents ask me to do something, when they're asking me to obey. They're like, hey, go do this. And you're like, right? Kind of throwing a little tantrum. It's not that. That's not respectful to your parents. They're like, hey, do this. And you're like, and like you do that thing where you mumble underneath your breath as you're walking away, right? Parents, we hate that, right? What'd you say, right? It's not great. With respect, obedience with respect. Be respectful to your parents. Number two, with urgency. When they ask you to do something, do it right away. Do it right away. Here's the reason behind this, is that if they ask you to do something, they're like, hey, go clean your room. That's a common one, right? Go clean your room. And you're like, maybe not. I don't want to do that. I'm not going to do that right now. I'll do it later. In that moment, you have just disobeyed your parents. They said, go do it. And you're like, I think I'll do it on my own time. Maybe I won't do it at all. Who knows? Right? With urgency, we need to obey our parents right away, lest we fall into disobedience immediately. And third, with excellence. With excellence. When your parents ask you to do something, you should be doing it with excellence. Right? I am going to clean my room so good that you could literally eat off of it. Off the floor. Here we go. I'm going to clean it so well. I'm going to do it so excellently. Right? That's how we should be obeying, because ultimately, it pleases the Lord. It's for the Lord. It pleases the Lord. It pleases him. So, children, obey your parents. And then here's another thing in verse 21. It says this, fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. Fathers, we need to be encouraging your children. Fathers, encourage your children. Well, just when you thought you found another verse that you could stick in someone's face without reading the next one, here's another convicting verse, specifically for fathers, but in general for parents. Do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. This is an exhortation to parents to raise their children in such a way that they do their utmost to avoid provoking a rebellious, defeated, and depressed attitude in your children. And provoking means to cause someone to feel resentment, to make resentful, to make someone bitter, to make someone irritated in anger. This is caused by over-severe and unjust treatment. Without the ability to get healing from that injured sense of justice for the child, which then leads to them being spiritless, resigned, despaired, wounded, and discouraged. When we provoke our children, we discourage them. They're not obeying then out of joy in the Lord and joy for us and obedience to us. They're doing it under compulsion, and they're discouraged, and they don't want to do it. They don't want to. Let me give you some context here, because I think it's really important. What's the problem Paul's addressing? What is the problem specifically that Paul's addressing here with fathers not provoking their children, leading them to be discouraged? Well, I think it begs the question, well, how strict really were parents in the day of Paul? And so I found some quotes from a man who lived just a little bit after Paul, and his name is Ben Sirach. And here are some quotes specifically talking about how parents should discipline their children. You ready for this? Quote, "Bow down his neck in his youth and beat his sides while he is young." It keeps going. "A father who loves his son will whip him often. Fathers have the right to upbraid their children and admonish them severely. And if they do not submit to threats conveyed in words, beat and degrade them and put them in bonds." Another person a little bit closer to our own time is an English Puritan named Bartholomew Batty. And Batty was a little batty. He said this, "God specifically created the buttocks for children to receive just correction with stripes and blows without causing serious bodily injury." So I'd say pretty strict, right? They're pretty awful. And this is not how we should be viewing our role as parents, not as a torturer, right? Now, this doesn't mean to not discipline your children. You should absolutely do this. And it doesn't mean don't correct your children. You should absolutely do that as well. And it doesn't mean don't give them consequences, because you should absolutely do that as well. It means be responsible, be wise, be intentional, and above all else, be God-honoring with the way you discipline, correct, and guide your children. Now, let me say this before I continue. I love my mom. I love my mother. We have an amazing relationship now. We didn't have an amazing relationship in high school, mostly because I was the worst. I was awful. But my mom said that I could use this story to illustrate this point. So my mom was a pretty intense wrestling mom, like super intense. Let me give you a little context. In a 16,000 person arena, I was wrestling. My mom was on the top row of said arena, and I could hear her shouting at me while I was wrestling. She was shouting wrestling moves, and I'm like, that's so weird. I can hear my mom. She was intense. She was intense, and she cared a lot about my wrestling, which was awesome. Not awesome for me. It was fine. But during wrestling, it was quite something to behold. And she got a little emotional sometimes in some matches that I was in. And so there was one match that I lost and I shouldn't have, and I wrestled poorly. And my mom got a little bit over emotional about that. And so I stepped off to the side. My mom, who was on the other side of the field house, just started walking towards me. You know? And so she's walking across the mats. There are wrestling matches taking place. And she's like, she's marching across it. She was on a mission. And she came up to me. And we laugh about this now, by the way. This isn't a bad story. She came up to me and she pointed her finger right in my face. And then she said something. I'm not going to share that because I want to honor my mother and I love her very much. She said something discouraging to me. And it was a little discouraging. It was. And my mom would admit, of course, that that was not her greatest moment. And I would agree. But do you see how easily something like that can happen? Now, of course, my mom asked for forgiveness after that and came back to encourage me. But so easily that exact thing can happen. We could get emotional about something and we could go straight to speaking harshly, to speaking out of anger, to speaking not in love towards our children. We have to be very intentional with our children in commands and correction and in consequences. And so here's an application for us. These are some common ways to discourage your child. Common ways to discourage your child. The first one is unclear rules. Unclear rules. You can discourage your child pretty quickly if you have unclear rules. If they don't know that they're breaking a rule and you punish them for that, that's immediately discouraging for your children. You have to have clear rules. This is what we do. This is what we don't do. Clarity. Clarity on rules. When they're unclear, it discourages your child. Number two, inconsistent discipline. This is both the frequency and the severity. It's the frequency of inconsistent discipline. One day I get in trouble for an action, and then the next day I do the same thing and I don't get in trouble. That could be discouraging. Or the severity. The punishment does not fit the crime, right? Getting grounded for 2 months because you said the word poop, and that's a potty word, right? Inconsistent discipline, both frequency and severity, that's discouraging to your child. Number three, uncontrolled emotions. Uncontrolled emotions. When I let my anger and my temper get out of control, the way that I speak to my child, not out of love, but out of emotion, out of anger. I don't like what you're doing right now. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to let you know. Going over the top, overboard, over severe, because your emotions are a little bit out of control. That happens, doesn't it? And we have to be really careful to not do that because that discourages our children. Number four, unconfessed failure. Unconfessed failure. The failures that I have as a parent. Because if I'm not doing that, then my children know that I'm a hypocrite. If I'm not confessing my failure. And so you have an awesome opportunity as a parent to show your children humility, to show them that you mess up too. And then you can teach them how to biblically handle sin by your example. Uncontrolled failure is a way to discourage your child. And then finally this, if you have more than one, favoritism. Favoritism. You're showing favoritism to one of the children, that leaves the other one very discouraged. And so treating them equally, maybe not the exact same because they're different human beings, but equally giving your time to them. All right, we're going to go quickly through these next two because the time is already gone. Thanks for sticking with me. So the last two points that we have, starting in verse 22, we're going to see that workers serve God faithfully. Workers serve God faithfully. Verse 22 says, "Bondservants, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ. For the wrongdoer will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality." There is no partiality. So bondservants here were these were servants. Some would say slaves in biblical terms, and they would often work in the household of the master. And the reason that it's translated bondservant here is because it's a bit more accurate than servant or slave. These people were certainly not paid the first century equivalent of minimum wage, but they were paid something. So it was more like a lifetime employment contract than really racial slavery. All that to say is that these people were the actual property of their masters, so slave and servant are not too far off of this definition. Now, I don't think that we have anyone in this room that is in a contract like this. And if you are, please let us know. We would love to help you. There are laws against this, right? But we can certainly apply this to our lives in the area of maybe employer-employee or leader-worker relationship. So if you're an employee, if you're a worker, you are to obey everything. You're to obey everything. Not by way of eye service, as the scripture teaches, which is to say, not just when the boss is looking. I'm not just obeying when the boss is looking. Not people-pleasing, trying to please my boss, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. The reality is that you should be doing what you're doing to please the Lord, fearing God. We should do this work, whatever it is, heartily as for the Lord and not for men. That's what the scripture says. Completely committed to serve as if the boss, the master, the leader was the Lord himself, because ultimately that's who we're serving. Then Paul lays out two reasons really quickly. From the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. This is the reward of obeying this, is that you will receive inheritance as your reward. You may not be getting your dues now. You may be overworked, underappreciated, underpaid, treated poorly, but someday God is going to reward you because it is him you serve. As a worker, as a servant, whatever and whomever it is, it's all for the Lord. And so whatever hardship you're facing, do not let that affect the work you're doing for the Lord. And he is ultimately the one that pays you. The second reason Paul gives is a warning. The wrongdoer will be paid for the wrong he has done. There is no partiality. If you fail at doing this, if you fail at working like this, you will be disciplined by the Lord. You will be punished with no partiality, no favoritism, no special treatment because you're a Christian. Doesn't matter if you're a Christian or because you're facing hardship. If you disobey, it doesn't give us the right to disobey the Lord. We have to be obedient. I love this quote as an application of how we should serve as workers. It's by Martin Luther King. It says, if a man is called to be a street sweeper, he should sweep streets even as Michelangelo painted, or Beethoven composed music, or Shakespeare wrote poetry. He should sweep streets so well that all the hosts of heaven and earth will pause to say, here lived a great street sweeper who did his job well. May that be true of us. Whatever we do, whatever it is, that the host of heaven and earth will say, this is a man or a woman who did their job well, as unto the Lord. And here's the last thing. Leaders, masters, bosses, leaders treat others justly. Chapter 4, verse 1. Masters, treat your bondservants justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. In other words, do unto others as you believe the Lord would do unto you. Treat them justly as the Lord would treat you. And we live in a work culture that says, use people to get what you want. Those below you are worth less. Step on them to advance if you need to. Throw your workers under the bus to make yourself look better. Give your workers only the minimum that they need to do the work and what they are worth so that you can enjoy all of the benefits. That is not being a leader. That's being a tyrant. No matter how big of a boss you are, no matter how much power you hold, how much leadership you have, what high position you have, remember there is always someone higher than you. His name is God, and he is watching. This is a call to understanding that you are not at the head of the org chart. That position is filled alone by God. So treat your workers fairly and justly according to what is morally right and fair, understanding and knowing that you have a master that you will have to answer to in heaven. These are the ways that God has ordered the family to function in the home. And the beautiful news about all of this is that when we have this down, when we do this in our own home, we can better take this to the world and be salt and light to those who are around us, bringing these characteristics wherever we go. And when people see that you have a great marriage based on the word of God, and when people see that you have great kids based on the word of God, and great relationships with your family based on the word of God, a change in attitude at work, as a worker or a boss, because of the word of God, people are gonna ask, how? Why? And your response is because Jesus Christ has changed my life. And he's changed my family's life as well. And you can have that too. It starts in the home. We need to get these down in the home so that we can take them to the ends of the earth, bringing the power of Jesus with the whole way. Amen. Let's go after this week. Let me pray for us. Father, we're so in need of you. Help us, Lord. Help us to do these things. These are difficult things. These are things, though, that need to happen in our lives. Lord, help wives submit in love to their husbands. Lord, help husbands love their wives and not be harsh with them. Lord, help children obey their parents in everything. Lord, help fathers and parents not to provoke their children, but to encourage them. Lord, help us as workers and as leaders treat each other fairly and justly, but work heartily as unto you, Lord. We're doing it all for you. Everything that we do in word or deed, Lord, is done for you. Help us with this as we go throughout our week. We love you, Lord, and we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 This is a charge for us to go and do this. These are the things Paul is saying. You got to have this. You got to have all of that putting off, putting on, bringing it all together. And then these roles and how we should interact and be in relationship with one another at the home. And so let's go after these this week. Don't leave it here. Bring it with you as you go into your homes this week, serving the work, serving the Lord with the work heartily as unto him in his name. Amen. Amen. Have a great week. You are loved.